Please welcome the Executive Director of the Radio Television Digital News Foundation and Association, Dan Shelley.
Good evening, everyone. Please be seated. Thank you so much for being with us tonight. Please take your seats. Good evening, everyone. We're so happy you're here. Please take your seats. Good evening. Please take your seats. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Radio Television Digital News Foundation 28th Annual First Amendment Dinner. Thank you. This is one night in our nation's capital during which we can find safe haven from cries of fake news and enemy of the American people. And we can celebrate the very first of our constitutionally enshrined Bill of Rights. The First Amendment protects religion, assembly, the right to petition the government, speech, and of course the press. And it is that particular protection that we are gathered here tonight to commemorate. Never in our nation's modern history has it been more dangerous to be a journalist. According to the U.S. Press Freedom Tracker, of which RTDNF is a founding partner, there were 44 physical attacks on journalists across the country in 2017 alone. There have already been a handful so far this year. Last year, there were 34 arrests of journalists in America. Reporters and photojournalists who were handcuffed, jailed, pepper sprayed, and sometimes violently assaulted by police officers just for doing their constitutionally guaranteed duty to serve the public. So toxic is today's environment that newsrooms have had to drastically increase security. Some news organizations have felt it necessary to send their crews into the field with armed security guards. Extremists all along the ideological spectrum have felt emboldened to lash out, often too harshly, at responsible journalists whose work they either just don't like or just don't understand. Somehow, in America, it has become acceptable to some to sell, buy, and even wear t-shirts that read, "Rope, Tree, Journalist, Some Assembly Required." Replace the word journalist with any other profession. Rope, tree, teacher, some assembly required. Rope, tree, police officer, some assembly required. Rope, tree, rabbi, some assembly required. Can you imagine the universal outrage? Why then should it be acceptable to wear a t-shirt that openly advocates the lynching of American journalists? Let me tell you something, it is not okay. And that's why late last year, RTDNF and our parent association, RTDNA, compelled Walmart, the nation's largest retailer, to stop selling those damn shirts. Early the very next morning, they suddenly showed up on Amazon, and we helped compel Amazon to stop selling the shirts. The next day, the shirts showed up on eBay, and the seller who was offering them there said, and I quote, "Banned by Walmart, so we made copies." We helped compel eBay to remove those shirts as well. Those t-shirts were removed from America's largest e-commerce platforms thanks to the work of the RTDNA Voice of the First Amendment Task Force, which we formed more than a year ago after top executives of companies that run local newsrooms across the country came to us and asked for our help because they were seeing the consequences suddenly of the most dishonest people in the room, which had been targeting mostly the national news media prior to the 2016 election, starting to affect their news crews in communities throughout the land. Our Voice of the First Amendment Task Force has done more than stem the sales of threatening t-shirts. It's fought dozens of battles at the federal, state, and local levels to speak out against threats to press freedom, to provide legal advice to journalists who have been unjustly jailed, and to newsrooms that have been targeted by unfair lawsuits or obstructionist court rulings. And it has worked hard to help the public better understand why outstanding responsible journalism is essential to their daily lives. And that is the main reason we are here tonight. We are here to honor outstanding responsible broadcast and digital journalism. Specifically, we are here to reward particular honorees who serve as symbols and role models for speaking the truth to power, for having the courage to become a pioneer in what is now the Me Too movement, for running a news division with a storied history of amazing journalism, for providing badly needed context to the mess that is, sadly, Washington today, and for devoting one's entire life to seeking and reporting the truth. None of tonight's honorees, and no one else in this room, is a purveyor of fake news, and no one in this room is an enemy of the American people. Something very good, actually, has emerged during these perilous times for the First Amendment. Tonight's responsible journalist honorees and the news organizations they represent and many other news outlets have stepped up their games. They've heeded the call that I and others have made during the past year that the only antidote to attacks on journalism is more and better journalism. They have exposed corruption and hypocrisy. At the national and local level, journalists have shined a light on problems that otherwise would have gone unnoticed. Often the work of journalists has served as catalysts for positive change here in Washington and in communities throughout the United States. We as a society need investigative journalists more than ever. Thank you, but those aren't my words. They're the words of Michigan Assistant Attorney General Angela Povilaitis, spoken in open court at the sentencing hearing for former USA Gymnastics doctor and convicted serial child molester Larry Nassar in January. Povilaitis could not have been more correct. Were it not for the First Amendment and solid investigative journalism, Nassar, in her words, would still be abusing kids. There are many other outstanding examples of responsible investigative journalism, some of the best of which we honored in the 2017 RTDNA National Edward R. Murrow Awards. Let's take a look at just a few.
We're in ISIS territory. It's clearly marked. The convoy slows down, and on the soldiers' faces, nerves begin to show. And then the roads give way to muddy alleys. There's nowhere to turn. It's so claustrophobic. And every car here, every garbage can, could be a bomb.
Giselle and Jeff's only child was found in the cattails directly across from their beach. His kayak was bottom up in the water. Brennan had drowned, wearing his life jacket, upside down in his seat.
The sheriff brought us over there because I wanted to hold him one last time.
No one knows why Brennan's kayak rolled or why he was unable to get back up. But his parents still hope.
I'll try to get the
some good can come.
So we asked the Rapids Riders Whitewater Canoe and Kayak Club to help us help the next Brennan.
It's for marketing.
This New Orleans area pharmacist asked us to hide his identity, contract with pharmacy benefit managers, or PBMs prevent him from talking publicly. But documents multiple pharmacists gave to Fox 8 News show in some cases companies charge you a copay that's more than the cost of the drug.
During a routine job at Hanford, he was working right outside what's known as the C Farm, where workers are transferring nuclear waste out of leaking tanks.
I'd just been fighting, getting worse, and to the point where I thought I was dying.
Seth's been monitoring radiation at the site for 12 years, but it took just a few minutes for his career, his health, his life to come to a standstill.
It got really strong, kind of overwhelming.
On August 31st of 2015, Seth began smelling something odd, suspected chemical vapors. He got out of there, but felt the effects immediately.
I started having breathing problems the same day.
Available by physician order for as little as $299. Pathways Marketing claimed it could do what others say is years away.
Cancer Intercept can detect a growing tumor in the body before the patient may notice symptoms. It's like a cancer stethoscope for detecting and monitoring cancer.
A few weeks ago, we visited Pathway to ask them about their claims. Before we sat down with the CEO, Jim Plant, they played us that marketing video.
We just watched a video upstairs.
Right.
And it says the liquid biopsy will detect cancer before symptoms.
Yeah, may. So we
say. Well, that's
not
what the video says.
It says it may. We don't say what. We don't say will. We say may.
You don't make the claim that you can detect cancer?
We say the information can be used to help guide a potential early diagnosis.
They are the drivers we're supposed to trust to get our kids to school safely. But records and videos we've obtained show them driving dangerously hundreds of times. And believe it or not, those drivers were never punished until we started asking questions. Caught on video, big yellow school buses blowing past red lights, risking dangerous collisions.
This is one of the more dangerous violations that we would write tickets for.
We watched the videos with NBC5 law enforcement expert Don Peritz,
had he actually stopped
a former sheriff's department traffic commander. One bus driver nearly rear-ending a car, then whipping into another lane and running the red light.
And now you have bus drivers ignoring the red signal and endangering everyone around them because they're either in such a hurry or not paying attention.
Thank you to those journalists, thank you to our honorees tonight, and thank you to you for being here, for supporting the First Amendment, and for supporting the efforts of RTDNF. It's now my great honor to introduce the chairman of the Radio Television Digital News Foundation, News Director for Michigan Radio, Vincent Duffy.
Thank you, Dan, and good evening, everybody. Thank you for coming tonight to help us honor the work of these outstanding broadcasters and helping RTDNF in its mission to defend our First Amendment freedoms, provide training and scholarships to electronic journalists, and to honor those whose work and careers are examples of that excellence and that commitment to the press freedoms. This is our 28th First Amendment Awards dinner. It was through the efforts of foundation trustees such as George Glazer and his wife, Mina, who were a driving force in starting the First Amendment Awards dinners. We lost George in December of 2016, and sadly, his wife, Mina, died last week at the age of 84 and was laid to rest just yesterday. The Glazers were instrumental in getting financial support for the broadcast groups, or from the broadcast groups, rather, for those early dinners, and Mina even got Jane Fonda to help her out to get support for those first dinners. I'm proud to announce tonight that the Glazer family's commitment to the First Amendment and this foundation and to education will continue through the George and Mina Glazer Scholarship. Their son, Brian, Brian is himself a longtime friend of the foundation and a former CNN correspondent. He's launching this scholarship in honor of his parents, whose love of RTDNF and the First Amendment dinner, Brian says, showed no bounds. Brian is with us this evening. Let's have another round of applause for Brian and the Glazer family for their past efforts and future commitments to RTDNF. Thank you, Brian. I'd like to take a moment to recognize some other very special guests that are with us tonight. From the Federal Communications Commission, Commissioner Michael O'Reilly and Commissioner Mignon Clyburn. From the U.S. House of Representatives, the Honorable Eric Swalwell. And from the U.S. Senate, the Honorable Kirsten Gillibrand. Thank you for being here with us tonight and for your support. This year, RTDNF awarded more than a dozen scholarships and fellowships to students and working journalists. I'd like to recognize one of our scholarship winners who is here tonight. Mirady Zugga from Howard University is our inaugural Lee Thornton Scholar. Lee Thornton was the first African-American woman to cover the White House for a major news network, CBS. There's Mirady over there. Thornton was also the first African-American host of All Things Considered on NPR, and I'm sure she would be proud to know that the first scholarship in her name went to a student from Howard University, where Dr. Thornton was on the faculty. As Dan mentioned, it's been a challenging year for those of us who value the First Amendment and what it means for the press freedoms in our country. But tonight is about celebrating success. Tonight we honor those who work to defend our press freedoms and those who have shown us that great journalism can be done because of those press freedoms. I have the honor of presenting our first award tonight, the First Amendment Defender Award. This award is presented to an individual or to an organization who takes a public stand in support of press freedom. And this year, RTDNF is presenting the award to Congressman Eric Swalwell, who represents California's 15th District. He's introduced the Journalism Protection Act, which would make it a federal crime to assault journalists. In his press release, he said it represents a clear statement that assaults against people engaged in reporting is unacceptable, and it helps make sure that law enforcement is able to punish those who interfere with news gathering. How could we not agree? It's my pleasure to present this year's First Amendment Defender Award to Congressman Eric Swalwell.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Vincent. Thank you, RTDNF. And also thank you to other defenders of the First Amendment who are just as deserving of this award, the men and women in our armed services who were here earlier this evening. I want to thank my wife, Brittany, who is here with me tonight as well. Thank you for joining me. Now, I've been working for a free press since I was about 10 years old. My first job was as a newspaper delivery man, rode a bicycle in my neighborhood, and I would sit on the porch folding up the papers, putting the rubber bands on them, and my mom would always say to me, you know, that paper ain't gonna deliver itself. You better get it out before sunset, otherwise she was gonna have to drive me. And the reason I was so interested in reading the paper was because I wanted to know what was going on. And that's what you do in your mediums every day. You tell people what was going on. Fifth grade, I ran for student body president on a platform of sodas in the, you know, foyer and a school newspaper. And to my surprise, I won. To my parents' surprise, I won. And they had to buy me a typewriter, so I had to write a student newspaper every month. I've seen the importance of what you do and why you do it. I wrote the Journalist Protection Act to make it a federal crime for any person who commits an act of violence or intimidates a journalist from doing their job. Now, I want to assure you, I know there's some anxiety. There's a journalist exception for any journalist-on-journalist crime that may occur in a press scrum outside the House gallery or the White House briefing room. And I also want to address the elephant in the room. I've heard some of the criticism of this bill, some of it from voices in the media. I want to make it absolutely clear. I did not write this bill just to protect my friend Tucker Carlson from his guests. Tucker can protect himself. But in all seriousness, we've seen the attacks on the media, and we've seen that in recent years, those attacks have been emboldened by a president who has called you the enemy of the American people. But hostility towards the media began before the election of Donald Trump, and it won't go away when he does. This is something I saw firsthand when I was a prosecutor in Alameda County back in 2007. And I have to credit Josh Richmond, my communications director on our staff, for helping me with this bill. Josh was a reporter for the Oakland Tribune, and he saw a fellow journalist in our community murdered when he was covering a crime family, and assassinated and had other members of his family intimidated. Chauncey Bailey was the journalist. We've seen firsthand how dangerous it is for you to report. And this bill would make sure that if a crime is not prosecuted locally because there's no courage or a lack of will or because of politics, that in every corner of America, there's a federal protection, a federal jurisdiction. That's how important your work is, and that's how important the freedom of press is to our democracy. So thank you for fighting for it. I hope this finds more Republican and Democratic supporters so that you can keep doing your good work. Thank you so much.
If you support the goals and the mission of RTDNF, there's no better way to show that support than to provide a gift to the RTDNF Permanent Endowment Fund. Events like tonight, they help pay for the day-to-day expenses of the foundation, but the endowment will make sure that we can provide the resources to fight for the First Amendment and to provide scholarships for years to come. We launched our fundraising efforts for the endowment last year, and you can become a member of the Barney Oldfield Founders Circle with a $500 contribution to the RTDNF Endowment Fund through the end of this year. Now, Barney Oldfield was the founder of RTDNF, and joining the Oldfield Circle is a great way to show your dedication to the foundation that he created and its mission of supporting journalism. There's more information if you're interested in this in your programs. And now let's start the show. Please join me in welcoming our Master of Ceremonies tonight, CBS News Senior Affairs Correspondent and moderator of Face the Nation, Margaret Brennan.
Good evening to all of you, and thank you very much. I'm delighted to be here, and I know for all of us who truly believe that information is the currency of democracy, we can greatly appreciate nights like this and support like we're seeing. And I want to quickly go on to our first award tonight, which is the Leonard Zeidenberg Award. It's named for the late broadcasting and cable senior correspondent. The award's presented annually to a radio or television journalist or news executive who has made a major contribution to the protection of First Amendment freedoms. To bestow tonight's Leonard Zeidenberg Award, please join me in welcoming my friend and the chief foreign affairs correspondent for NBC News, host of MSNBC's Andrea Mitchell Reports, Andrea Mitchell.
Margaret and I have spent a lot of time on State Department planes over the last decade, and congratulations to her for getting a real job. And in the spirit of Morning Joe, which is what we're celebrating in this award and the First Amendment, I just have to share breaking news, which you'll all see on Morning Joe at 6 a.m. tomorrow, that the South Korean National Security Advisor has announced that the president has accepted an invitation from Kim Jong-un for a meeting before May, which is obviously pretty exciting. I can't wait to hear Mika and Joe's take, as we haven't even talked about all this that has just happened in the last 20 minutes, for those of you not on your phones. But that's why we need Morning Joe. For the past decade, Joe Scarborough and Mika Brzezinski have been getting us up every morning, some of us earlier than others, certainly all of those around the table. But the fact that they have done this for 10 years now is extraordinary. And what they bring to morning television is smart, pointed, well-informed interviews, sparkling debate, a groundbreaking program that has truly transformed morning television. Starting modestly, almost at the beginning in Java Joe's, in downtown Des Moines, with Mika losing her suitcase and wearing, I don't know what you were wearing that day, but what a way they have changed the way we consume news in the morning. Every day delivering important issues to viewers at 6 a.m., debating the day's biggest stories with a round table of political insiders and award-winning journalists, featuring interviews with all of the top newsmakers, making news as often as reporting it. They are fierce leaders. They exercise their own First Amendment rights, boy do they ever, while using their considerable platform to help others raise their voices. They have empowered so many people. Time magazine summed up Morning Joe with one simple word: revolutionary. The New York Times ranked Morning Joe one of the top news shows and praised Joe and Mika for their natural repartee and their off-the-cuff commentary. Very off-the-cuff at times. What sets them apart, not just that they are so frank, so open, so refreshing, so smart, is all of this is one of the keys to their success, that they are absolutely so knowledgeable about all of the developments around the world, and also their passionate advocacy. They are fearless. They are not afraid to speak up and to be a voice for the public. Prior to joining MSNBC in 2007, Mika was an anchor of the CBS Evening News Weekend Edition and a CBS News correspondent who frequently contributed to CBS Sunday Morning and to 60 Minutes. Mika Brzezinski has written 4 books, including Knowing Your Value, which will be re-released this fall in a revised and expanded edition. And a salute to Mika, who was a fearless voice when it was not fashionable and ahead of the curve in empowering women. And in addition to the re-release as well, we remember that it was all the way back in 2014 that Mika first launched Know Your Value, the digital media platform and conference event series dedicated to empowering women to achieve their highest potential in their professional and personal lives. Mika has been an outspoken advocate of women's rights and equal pay in the workplace. Next month, the New York Women in Communications will honor Mika with a 2018 Matrix Award for her extraordinary achievements in the industry. Joe, of course, served as a member of Congress from 1994 to 2001, and while in office, he served on Judiciary, on Armed Services, and on the Education Committees. He's the 2-time New York Times best-selling author. He writes a weekly column on politics for the Washington Post, and he is an accomplished rocker. So it is such a privilege for me to present this award for their fierce advocacy on behalf of the First Amendment to Mika Brzezinski and Joe Scarborough of Morning Joe.
Good morning and welcome to Morning Joe.
Good morning and welcome to Morning Joe.
We got a lot going on.
As we launch into the weekend, we have so many developing stories.
The First Amendment is an essential pillar of our democracy.
It has enabled us to have the concepts
of freedom, real freedom.
Free speech is difficult sometimes, it can be challenging, but it is good and necessary in itself.
This is a time when good journalism matters more than at any time I can remember in my career.
There have to be people out there speaking truth to power.
What Joe and Mika have done with Morning Joe is to create a forum that sets the day up for anybody who cares about public affairs. It's the place people go to express the ideas that are going to be decisive during that next day, that next news cycle.
More people will die in America by guns this year and next than died in a decade in Vietnam. If you are a gun activist, you are lied to all the time, and you are told that having military-style weapons or assault-style weapons are your constitutional right, that it's embedded in the Second Amendment, it's embedded in the Constitution. It is not.
Enemies of the First Amendment want us to self-censor. And I think that Joe and Mika, we can certainly see there has been no self-censorship.
Senator, is it fair to say the president has not told the truth at times on any level, on anything?
This interview has to stop in its tracks until I just get a yes-no answer from you on whether you believe it's important that Americans find out whether their president believes that climate change is a conspiracy theory based out of China.
Mika often talks about the importance of sticking to your gut and not being afraid to speak your mind.
With the Paris Hilton story.
At this point, those briefings are useless. She's the one protecting a president who watches TV every day and tweets stupidity, lies. You have been fighting so hard for free speech so you can write some of the most astounding things I've ever read in my life over the past few decades, and yet you won't give them a moment to use their voices? That's cruel hypocrisy.
What's wonderful about the show is that you can go on and say anything about anyone. And Joe generally does.
The President of the United States making every one of his spokespeople out to be liars. If you're an audience and John McCain's getting attacked and he's fighting for his life, all right, unless you were raised in a barn, keep your mouth shut. Millennials, you just had $1.5 trillion stolen from you. And over the next 10 years, you're going to steal another $10 trillion. And then you're going to be left holding the bill. This is completely reckless, and I could not find one person inside the White House, and I spoke to many this weekend, that defended Donald Trump.
This show started 10 years ago with the premise that it would be a place where intelligent people could speak their minds and disagree in a way that was civil and would enhance civil debate.
The honor and the responsibility of journalists are more important than ever before. And I think Joe and Mika in their morning show, collaborating with a group of people who talk with them continually, have kept up that tradition.
There was nothing like Morning Joe before. A lot of us thought this was a crazy idea. They're going to sit around a table. They're going to just like talk.
That's what we tell our kids to take a chance.
They created something genuinely new, yet in a way genuinely old. It was like a sort of community gathering where people get together and talk about the news. In an intelligent, sort of probing and often very brave way.
Republicans just don't care about the debt when they're the ones in the White House jacking it up.
Almost every small town has a group of men and women who every day get together and talk politics.
The cat dragged in something.
Yeah.
Cat dragged in a lobster.
What Joe and Mika have done with Morning Joe is just taken that tradition and expanded it. And they can be argumentative as well and not always agree with what they hear on Morning Joe, but at least they're involved and they're a part of it.
Well, let me say to everybody, very humble.
He says thank you.
Thank you so much.
Barack Obama's victory, and there is the picture of President Obama.
This is a great blanking show, isn't it?
The operation that killed Osama bin Laden.
The president not being afraid to engage in what was really a high-risk operation.
On the 20th, it was Trump's crowd, and it was a decidedly red state American crowd. And then on the 21st, just the opposite.
Mika, you are a good role model for women who show that you can take a licking and keep on ticking.
We need to find our voices. Stop apologizing. Raise your voice when you need to, but always own it.
Just keep doing what you're doing. You're trying to help America every time you tell a truth on TV.
And what is Aleppo?
You're kidding.
No.
And I think the life of the Republic is better for what Mika and Joe are doing.
You guys got the morning thing down.
It is what everybody I know in Washington is listening to and watching.
The level of stamina it takes is just phenomenal. And to be on top of the issues, to keep going morning after morning, hats off to you.
I'm tired of being tired. Are you tired of being tired? I think it's a different thing.
I've been tired of being tired for a long time.
Wake up at 3:30 tired of being tired.
Of all the things that I do, I get probably more feedback from an appearance on your show than any other.
I think we can call it their indelible contribution. I don't think morning TV will ever be the same again.
Donald, you're not going to keep talking. We will go to break if you keep talking. We're going to ask you questions.
All right, go to break.
It takes courage and it takes conviction to show up every morning and talk about what you believe and what you see. You take an awful lot of grief on instruments like Twitter, but to do it consistently, day in, day out, without fear, and mostly without favor, is quite an accomplishment.
But there is one great shortcoming. You've got the worst bagels I have ever seen in my life. Come on, guys. You're a big hit. You're a big success. Let's beef up the breakfast in the morning, okay?
The first 10 years, Mika and Joe.
Thank you so much.
Thank you guys so much. I would say that, thank you, go ahead. Thank you. Thank you guys. I would tell you that we don't deserve that, but many of you know that. I want to.
Andrea, that's what I was wearing in Java Joe's. It was.
Yeah. I want to follow up on what Andrea said, really briefly, talking about where the show really started, and really we always consider, even though we started it in May of 2007, the first day of the show really was when Tim Russert burst through the door at Java Joe's. And the Iowa caucus, I think it was like on January 2nd or 3rd in 2008. And he came in and asked if he could be on the show. And that's kind of like, for me, Paul McCartney asking, hey, do you mind if I play with your band? Now, that will never happen, but something better happened. Tim Russert asked if we minded if he would be on the show. And it was an extraordinary moment. But that took me back to what Phil Griffin told me when the show first started. And that was, he said, Joe, here's my only advice to you. Always think that you have an audience of one. And it's Tim Russert sitting in his home in Northwest Washington watching the show. And if every guest you have on the show and every segment you have on the show and every question you ask on your show is something that Tim would approve of, then you're doing pretty well. And we've fallen far short of that many, many times. But that was really our guiding star. And Mika, why you set the Paris Hilton scripts on fire.
I thought he would approve, but Phil gave us that advice and then he set us free and put so much trust in us. And it really was the best advice we ever got for the show. This is an incredible honor, and for us, we feel it's really an honor for the men and women who work around the clock to make Morning Joe possible, and there's not a lot of them. We're very small staff, and as someone who spent far too many years, decades actually, on an overnight shift, I know how crushing that work schedule can be, not just on the person working it, but on everybody in their lives. And we feel incredibly blessed every day when we take a look at our team with the bags under their eyes, dark circles, because we know that they are driven by the belief that now more than ever, Americans need to hear the news in a straightforward, unsparing manner. And as Marty Baron reminds
his Washington Post reporters every day, we're not going to war, we're going to work. And at Morning Joe, we work around the clock. Our team works around the clock.
And I love that. I love that saying that Marty has up on his office at the Washington Post. We're not going to war, we're going to work. It is a great reminder of our job, but we make no mistake of the fact, and the people in our office make no mistake of the fact, that times such as these do demand that our team beats back against the tide of brutish threats from the president and from some of his allies, and some of the threats that we heard about against other journalists, against the threat, actually, against my fiance from NRA TV, saying that her time is running out, and then ominously holding an hourglass and turning it over. We also know that it's our responsibility to call out those times when constitutional norms are being challenged, those times when the President of the United States actually channels Joseph Stalin and calls the media the enemy of the people. And those times when the White House and other politicians do all they can do to undermine the credibility of those who actually try to check their power. We're honored that you've recognized our team's effort. And we do want to thank Phil Griffin again. We want to thank Andy Lack. We, of course, want to thank David so much for all you've done. Not only David Cohen, but our entire Comcast family. And they are a family. You know, MSNBC is supposed to be such a liberal network, but at least since I've been there, especially under the leadership of Phil Griffin, he's been like the Koch brothers in the fact that it is laissez-faire. He lets you do your thing, lets you say what you're going to say, lets you run your show. And I can say this, over the past decade, Phil Griffin has never called us once and told us what we could say or what we couldn't say. And that is something that very few people in this room can say, especially our executive producer, Alex Corson, who hears from Phil every day, so we don't have to. Thank you, Alex. But anyway, we are allowed, because of Phil, we are allowed to speak freely, and we're allowed to speak freely without scripts and without fear, but also with a 7-second delay. But that's another
that
story.
That we have. And that 7-second delay is your fault.
I know.
Having said that, Joe makes fun of himself. I will just add that this whole show was your concept. And 10 years ago, Joe put together an idea to have a discourse among people who don't agree with each other, who maybe don't even like each other, but to find a place to come together in the morning and have a civil discourse, and one that is often extremely joyful to have. And I think you should be really proud of what you've created. I really do.
I think so.
We get to do this show 3 hours a day, 5 days a week, 52 weeks every year, and we cherish this opportunity. We cherish every moment. We also understand the remarkable responsibility and what is at stake, which is why we share this honor with all of you tonight, who work every day to protect the freedoms guaranteed to all Americans by our First Amendment. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Congratulations to you both, Joe and Mika. Now, the very best thing an MC can do is be brief and be seated. So with that in mind, I'm going to take us to our next award. RTDNF presents the annual Leadership Award to a business or government leader who has made a significant contribution to the protection of the First Amendment and freedom of the press. Here now to present the 2018 Leadership Award, please welcome to the stage United States Senator from New York, the Honorable Kirsten Gillibrand.
thank you, Margaret, for your introduction. Congratulations to Mika and Joe. That was a well-deserved award. I want to tell you why Gretchen Carlson is such an inspiring leader and why her work on this has meant so much to me personally. I believe very deeply that we all have a responsibility to speak out about the issues that matter most to us, that we all have a role to play in making our country a fairer place, that by raising our individual voices when we see injustices happening around us, we can change society to be more just. Gretchen Carlson very clearly believes that too. More than a year ago, when Gretchen came out and bravely told her story about the sexual harassment she had suffered in her workplace, very few people were speaking publicly about this issue. But Gretchen knew that she had a role to play. She knew she had a powerful story to tell, a story shared by too many women and men, many of whom can't speak out without fear of retribution. And she knew that she was in a rare position to be able to draw enormous attention to this problem. And now, thanks to Gretchen's courage and so many others who have spoken out, our entire country is having a conversation about what we in society are willing to accept. The Me Too movement has shown us that sexual harassment and sexual assault in the workplace are far more pervasive than anyone realized. And they're not just problems in the places that have received all the headlines, not just Hollywood, sports, the military, politics, and the media. These problems also exist in areas where there is no spotlight, where there's far less attention from the press, and where the risk posed by speaking out is just too great for those people. Places like restaurants, farms, factories, hotels, office building, in big corporations and in small businesses. Gretchen recognizes this, which is why her Gift of Courage Fund has done so much work to support organizations that empower women and girls from all walks of life. We've seen over and over again in institutions all around this country a culture where power and fear keep sexual assault and sexual harassment in the shadows. Harassment can be debilitating, it can be demoralizing, it can be destructive to the person who is just trying to do their job and provide for their families. It can inhibit someone's ability to do their best work, to excel, to earn a promotion, even to stay employed. It can create lasting scars, reduce self-confidence, destroy trust and morale. It is toxic to any organization, and it can ruin lives. So what can we do, all of us, to change this? What can we do as leaders, as employers, as supervisors, as people? Well, first, when someone speaks out about harassment or abuse, listen. Our businesses must take claims seriously and investigate them fairly and thoroughly. Second, we must change the climate so that people are not afraid to come forward, where they know a fair hearing and maybe even justice is possible. Workplaces should never protect predators and harassers, even if they are powerful. And most of all, and this is global in scope, we must value women. This means equal pay for equal work. Thank you. This means equal pay for equal work. It means equal opportunity for advancement and promotion, having a real paid leave program, supporting legislation to do that nationally, and recognizing that diversity is our strength in business and in society. And it means stopping workplace sexual harassment. The one way we can work toward that goal is by finally getting rid of forced arbitration clauses in employment agreements. When Gretchen told her story, one of the most painful details was that even after she had experienced such horrible treatment at work, she was forbidden from speaking out about it because of not only her forced arbitration clause, but her non-disclosure agreement. When a company has a forced arbitration policy, it means a worker who is sexually harassed or sexually assaulted gives up their constitutional rights to a jury trial. They are often paired with non-disclosure agreements, which gives up your right to speak about it to anyone in your workplace, to anyone publicly. It protects predators. It protects the company. With non-disclosure agreements, they are unable to talk about it with their colleagues. And after enduring all this, they are expected to go back to work and keep doing a good job as if nothing has happened to them. This is another area where Gretchen has shown incredible leadership. She has tirelessly walked the halls of the Capitol and done the hard work of convincing senators and House members, Democrats and Republicans, to sign a bipartisan bill to end forced arbitration in the workplace. Gretchen has been an amazing partner, along with Senator Lindsey Graham, in our effort to pass this bill. And I have no doubt that when this legislation passes, it will be because of Gretchen's voice, her powerful voice. People listen to her, they trust her, they believe her, and they are inspired by her. And now is my great honor to introduce Gretchen Carlson to accept the First Amendment Leadership Award. Come on up and then we'll watch your video.
We did not know it at the time, but she helped birth a movement. And in that, Gretchen Carlson embodies the spirit of the First Amendment. It was not easy to speak out about the harassment she faced, but she did at great professional and personal risk. And without question, others did the same because she led the way.
The sexual scandal that's rocking the movie world is hitting all too close to home for television journalist Gretchen Carlson.
Gretchen Carlson is the bravest woman I know, and I know a lot of brave women.
You sued one of the most powerful men in television. What made you come forward? Well, courage is a building process. It's not a light switch that you just turn on overnight. And I think that's really important, especially with this issue, because women are labeled troublemakers, the B word, and nothing good. They're not believed when they come forward. So it takes immense courage. It's an excruciating choice. But for me, I realized that my career, my American dream of 27 years of hard work, that it was going to come to an end and it wasn't my choice. Mm-hmm. And I decided that I had to speak up. If I didn't, who was going to do it? And I didn't want my children to face the same indignities that I had faced.
This is not just in Hollywood or in the TV business. This is everywhere. This is happening to women who don't have a voice or a platform.
Women are feeling more emboldened than ever before, and if I had anything to do with that, I am immensely proud. More and more women are saying, enough already, we're not going to put up with this anymore, and they're coming forward and they're putting their names and their faces to their stories, and I applaud them for that.
No matter our age, race, hometown, or job, I'm talking about police officers, waitresses, clerks, lawyers, doctors, members of our military, Hollywood actresses, journalists.
After a bold Time magazine cover, Gretchen used the power of her pen to write poignant and reflective columns for Motto, and was recently honored as one of Time magazine's 100 most influential people. Frequently addressing crowds at the country's top conferences and speaking engagements with her signature wit and candor, Gretchen exemplifies how you can truly have it all. A successful career, a fulfilling family life, and an altruistic purpose. Gretchen's highly anticipated second book, Be Fierce, Stop Harassment, and Take Your Power Back, hit the New York Times bestseller list in the first week.
We are on a movement. We are on a movement to speak up and be heard, and there's no turning back for women in the workplace. Why should women have the American dream taken away from them? We work just as hard as anyone else, and it's time that it stops. We have to make a pledge to one another that we are going to stand up and speak up. And now I'm seeing that something good is coming of this. My own daughter told me, when people ask me, what happened to you, Mom? I feel so proud to say you are my mom. And later, when she found the courage to stand up to kids making her life miserable,
She said, I knew I could do it, Mom, because I saw you do it. Giving that gift of courage is contagious.
The devil whispered in my ear, you are not strong enough to withstand the storm. Today I whispered in the devil's ear, I am the storm.
Thank you so much, first to this organization for honoring me tonight, to Senator Gillibrand for your time and your commitment. Thank you so much. It's an honor to be here tonight in such great company, and especially on this so important day as we're honoring International Women's Day. For more than 25 years, I've had the privilege of covering the biggest stories all across the nation. But besides being a journalist, I'm also a mom, a musician, an author, a philanthropist, a former Miss America, a sports junkie, and an advocate for women. Since my complaint against my former boss went public 20 months ago, I've added a few other duties to the list. Tonight, I'm standing before you as a survivor of sexual harassment in the workplace and sexual assault. I didn't intend to set off a national movement when I jumped off a cliff all by myself. Back then, there was no Me Too hashtag, no Time's Up movement, just one woman, me, trying to hold one man accountable. But since that excruciating choice, the biggest decision of my life, I've discovered that courage is contagious. When one woman speaks up, others feel empowered to follow. It's like a chain of inspiration. And because so many brave women have now spoken out, we are at a national tipping point. We are witnessing a cultural revolution of real change. But this moment would never have come about without you. Your reporting has been critically important in this movement, the titanic changes that are underway in our country. And on behalf of all harassment survivors, I want to say to you, thank you. The past 20 months have been about empowering women to come forward and telling their stories. But now the real work begins, because now we have to make the real changes happen. As Senator Gillibrand said, I've spent the last year walking the hallways to meet with members of Congress. And in December, I proudly joined the senator and others to introduce the Ending Forced Arbitration of Sexual Harassment Act, which restores victims' Seventh Amendment right. And here's the key to it. It was bipartisan. Imagine that, in the House and the Senate on the same day. I cannot overemphasize the need for this legislation. Today, more than 60 million Americans have forced arbitration clauses in their employment contracts. That number has doubled since the year 2000. It turns out that forced arbitration is the harasser's best friend. It keeps complaints and settlements secret. It allows harassers to stay in their jobs, even as victims are pushed out and fired. I know Senator Gillibrand and her colleagues are working incredibly hard to get this bill passed, and then it will go to the president's desk. And I'm proud to support their efforts because here's what I've learned and I know. Sexual harassment is apolitical. We've watched titans from both sides fall. Women from all walks of life and politics are subject to this abuse.
And that's why we should all care. On July 6, 2016, I was mostly known as Gretchen Carlson, journalist. But today, I'm proud to have added advocate to my resume. I'm proud to have started the Gift of Courage Fund to empower women and girls and boys. Proud to have started the Gretchen Carlson Leadership Initiative to help underprivileged women get the help they need with sexual harassment and domestic violence for free. Proud to have recently worked with the iconic Norman Lear as a reporter and EP for the upcoming season of America Divided. Proud to have recently taken on the huge volunteer job of executive chairwoman of the Miss America organization, bringing my Be Fierce movement to almost 100 years of tradition. Stay tuned for changes. But I'm most proud of the role that I have played in my life as a mom and as a role model for my two preteen children. They were my utmost concern, and I was so worried about their well-being. But I underestimated my own kids, because it turns out they've been given the gift of courage, too. Thank you for this important recognition and for your commitment to reporting the stories of millions of American women who never had their voices heard. Because we will not be underestimated, intimidated, or set back. We will not be silenced by the ways of the past or the establishment. No. We will stand up together, and we will use our voices, and we will show our courage. We will take back our power, and above all, we will always be fierce. Thank you.
Gretchen, congratulations, and thank you for your bravery. Now, before you all get to dig in, I want to take a quick break here and thank all of tonight's sponsors. The Diamond sponsors include my own CBS News, NBC News, MSNBC, Know Your Value, Comcast NBC, Universal, and Platinum sponsors include CNN and Hearst Television. So please enjoy your dinner. Bon appetit.
Margaret Brennan.
Thank you. Now, if I could have all of your attention, please, so we can get on with our awards tonight and I can get you home sort of close to schedule. I'm really trying. Thank you. The First Amendment Service Award honors professionals in local or network news who work behind the scenes in off-air management. And this year's award recipient is someone who I have been privileged enough to work with for the past 6 years at CBS and for some time before that as well. During a time when the integrity of the press and media at large is continually being called into question, David Rhodes has helped me and helped all of us at CBS News to stay focused on what we do best, hard news and original reporting. One of the first things that David did when he joined CBS News was to have the First Amendment painted on the wall of the broadcast center in big, bold letters. That way, everyone who walks the corridor to CBS this morning or the evening news is reminded of it on their way to deliver the broadcast. It sounds high-minded, but it is actually meant to keep us grounded. We are not the story. We are the storytellers. The CBS slogan, "News is back," tells you where David's own sensibilities are. And separating the interesting from the important has become ever more challenging in this deluge of a daily news cycle that we are all living through. Under David's leadership, CBS has also continued to cover international news stories at a time when the appetite and the real estate for foreign affairs has waned elsewhere. And he's taken a personal interest in the correspondence. If it has been a particularly heated and contentious press conference or interview, might have had a few of those, you can be sure that one of the first calls or notes you'll receive will be from David. Whether it's sending our Deborah Pata to the Democratic Republic of Congo to investigate child labor being used in the dangerous mining of cobalt, sending Seth Doan into Damascus to report on the latest atrocities in Syria, and here at home, having David Begno continue to shine light on the humanitarian crisis in battered Puerto Rico, alongside the daily domestic tornado of this Washington news cycle, David has pushed all of us at CBS News to help our viewers understand the big picture, to put things in context, and we're lucky to have him at the helm. So David, congratulations on this well-deserved honor. Now, let's embarrass him by taking a closer look at his remarkable career.
CBS is known for original storytelling, great reporting, original reporting. So when I think of David Rhodes, everybody in this building knows that his passion for real news is intense, and everybody understands that.
We were the first news crew allowed access.
Planes more than 100 feet tall.
Everything around here is within artillery range of North Korea.
I want to know your opinions. You're the president of the United States.
This is just one of the homes overtaken by mud.
Did you think you were going to die?
I am really happy to be working for a boss who leads the charge in supporting and encouraging original reporting all over the world.
These fighters are taking us to the front line.
Oh. Do you ever leave your house without a gun?
Never. I survive or be killed.
We are in the middle of protests to Palestinians here. Whoa.
Last month alone, the news division was on the ground in Cape Town, Israel, Mexico, Moscow, Myanmar, South Korea, Syria, and Yemen. David's leadership makes it possible for reporters to do their job in those places and not be dictated to from a desktop. He asked correspondents and producers to tell us what is happening from their perspective, not ours.
These are the worst winds we've seen.
Those of us covering Hurricane Maria in Puerto Rico knew the importance of that story. And David knew it too. He allowed us to stay there for as long as we needed.
Do you need more help?
Of course I do.
We lost everything.
You don't have anything at all.
Where's the army?
He asked what we needed, listened when we told him. And that really allowed our instincts to drive our coverage.
Because of your reporting, I ordered food to be delivered to the airport.
I hear you, but it's not getting to them.
Even when there isn't breaking news, you'll find him planted right in the middle of the newsroom, not far from our foreign and national desks. He's never forgotten what it's like to cover foreign news. He sent me for 3 weeks to cover child brides in Nepal.
So she says she's 17. She looks kind of like she's 12.
You've got someone for CBSN who just covered how technology affects the Rohingya crisis. He may be president of CBS News, but he's really a journalist at heart.
They do have a person who's been shot, they think by someone who was on a motorcycle.
When David speaks about the documentary we did on the killings of journalists in Mexico, it's clear that for him, this is something that is personal. It's an issue that he's worked to shine a spotlight on and fight against his entire career.
The subject is going to be a white male, possibly Nicholas Cruz.
We have new information about those terrifying moments before one of the deadliest school shootings in U.S. history.
An interaction I had recently with David, when we had the terrible shooting in Florida at the school, one of the videos we showed was the scene inside the classroom where you could hear the gunshots, where you could hear the children screaming. I remember being on the phone with David saying, I don't know if we should show that video. Number one, it makes me very uncomfortable. It's very painful to watch. And are we really doing viewers a service by showing them that? And he said to me, Gail, sometimes the news is uncomfortable. Sometimes the news is painful. And it's not our job to decide what that is. So yes, we're going to show it. And I got it. I got it.
The key to the way David Rhodes thinks about the news at CBS is that we want to cover what is important, not just what is in the moment, the flashy, shiny thing. We want to cover the stories that are going to affect people's actual lives. And one of the fixes that was discussed pre-existing was optional for the states.
Sure. In one of the fixes, and they're changing it
So it'll be permanent.
Of course.
Okay.
This is a development,
sir.
Hello, I'm Bill Whitaker with 60 Minutes.
We would not have known about this without 60 Minutes.
Why not implement the sanctions that Congress overwhelmingly says they want to see put on Russia? How close is Kim Jong-un to being able to deliver a nuclear attack to the territorial United States?
Do you care what the world thinks of the United States?
So this is something that a hacker hit. That's right, a hacker. Like, obviously, you didn't turn on the windshield wiper.
I did not.
Oh, my God. The horn.
Our slogan is, the news is back in the morning. And those aren't just empty words. That's just not a shallow sentence that we throw around. We take it very seriously.
It's at the heart of what CBS does. It's at the heart of David Rhodes' vision for the news.
I cannot think of many better ways to celebrate the First Amendment than by honoring a leader who understands it.
Thanks, Margaret. Like anyone should, Gail really did have difficulty with those images. And who wouldn't? Because seeing a school shooting unfold isn't anything that we should want to witness on tape or to hear. Because probably the sound is the most difficult part of those smartphone recordings of the shooting at Marjory Stoneman Douglas High School. That's not the only material that's hard to watch, disgusting even. We recently showed 60 Minutes viewers horrific images of a chemical weapons attack on civilians in Syria, hard to witness. Putting a camera in 2 billion pockets around the world is just one thing that's different about news coverage since 9/11, when we had just one film of the first plane hitting the towers, and the terrible events of that day unfolded with very little sound for most people experiencing them at home. Now, people can easily document an incident like Parkland. And so our discussion was, who are we to decide that the truth shouldn't be seen by a wider audience? If these images can be put in appropriate context by our reporters, aren't they important for people to see? Our job as a news organization is to reveal these events, not conceal them. Now, it was a fair criticism the day of the Parkland attack that these images need to be accompanied by warnings, need to be labeled appropriately. And we take on criticisms of the first airing, which came in a special report interrupting our broadcast network at CBS. But not showing these pictures at all just aids bad actors who fear that the truth could lead to policy consequences, or much worse, conspiracy theorists who want you to think that it didn't even happen. You have to ask yourself, who is being helped by us not doing this coverage? I'm so pleased to be joined by a number of colleagues tonight. Nancy Cordes is here. No one is better on the Hill covering Congress. She'll probably get the first criticism when we do something that upsets lawmakers. Jeff Pegues, taking a couple hours off of the lively federal law enforcement beat. Chip Reed, picking up the slack on his old White House assignment earlier in this week while we go through a transition there. Rita Braver, who is part of America's most beloved news magazine, which isn't in print, it's Sunday morning. David Begno, who I'm kind of surprised is not still in Puerto Rico. Still. Ed O'Keefe, who we hired just in time for this event, is here. Ed is our new CBS News political correspondent. Welcome, Ed. Paula Reed, who lets us know every time Bob Mueller goes out for coffee or James Comey moves his car. Margaret, emceeing tonight, is finding out that moderating a studio show each Sunday means presiding in a Washington hotel ballroom each Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. But on her path to face the nation, Margaret's press conference appearances did include a London Q&A with John Kerry that changed the course of the conflict in Syria, and a Trump Tower confrontation with the president that revealed his true feelings about last summer's events in Charlottesville. So thank you, Margaret, for that. And our Washington Bureau leadership is here. Mary Hager had a late conflict, but Bureau Chief Chris Isham is here, which means this is 3 hours of the week that I won't be calling Chris Isham. And more than all of that, my wife came. So Emma, thanks for everything. When the RTDNF reached out to me about this award, I love the idea behind it, what your program says about recognizing what goes on behind the scenes, because it's often there that the snap decisions on these issues need to be made, and by humans, since we don't have an algorithm in charge of press freedom, which I'll get to in a moment. But the First Amendment is a pretty thin reed, just four words in a subordinate clause, or of the press, give us constitutional protection. Thin, but not fragile. You were granted these freedoms. Use them. As Margaret noted, that's why we put the First Amendment on the wall in our broadcast center in New York, to remind people to use them. I said news gathering has changed, and it has. We've gone from information scarcity to information abundance in a very short span of time. Our newsrooms were once organized for a world where pictures were rare. Now, pictures are the easy part. It's making sense of them that's the hard part. Social media has changed the environment in which we make these decisions. Audience expectations have changed, and the platforms have done this not just by making information ubiquitous, but by presenting information only in the context of its popularity and not necessarily its authenticity. We try to balance right and wrong, and it's not too much to ask social media to balance true and false. Now, it should be said that it may once have been easier to manage these issues, but I also think it should be said that it wasn't better. In some ways, our profession's stewardship of these freedoms cried out for modernization. Some of the changes that you are seeing borne out in our workplaces, in standards of behavior, in more modern management, is a natural result of including more voices. We are only partway through that process. Taking out the misconduct and harassment, being more thorough about who gets opportunities and what they do with them. These are all part of hearing from more people inside and outside our news organization, getting the facts out, encouraging speech, drawing out the truth, revealing, not concealing. Our prescriptions as management will not be the same in every case and will sometimes not be popular. This is going to, at times, be a painful process that some would rather not go through. But our work is getting better and better for it. I sometimes hear it said that there's never been a time like this, or that press freedom has never been more delicate, or that it's different this time. And I'm sorry, but the political context is actually not all that different. There's a strenuous argument, including in this room, that our political leadership requires a new approach by us. But that's also an argument that our high standards need to come down, and they shouldn't. Attacks on the press are at a high volume, but they're not necessarily more sophisticated than they were in the past. And in some ways, there's more enthusiasm for our work than ever before. If you think these attacks are new, not so much. Recently, the FBI's file on the late Morley Safer was revealed, and it was passed around by some colleagues in our newsroom, and I read it. And it revealed that indeed Morley was Canadian. But more importantly, it showed that the Bureau had investigated our correspondent only because his reports on the Vietnam War were deemed unfavorable, that the images were too graphic, inappropriate. So it sounds familiar. I'm honored to have this award on behalf of everyone that I work with at CBS News. I hope no one tails you on the way home just for having been here. And thank you. And please stay dedicated to the principles that we're all celebrating here tonight. Thanks so much.
Congratulations to David. The RTDNF prestigious First Amendment Award champions the very essence of press freedoms. And this year, we honor a truly exemplary organization. Here to bestow the award, please welcome back to the stage the Chief Foreign Affairs Correspondent for NBC News, Andrea Mitchell.
Thank you again, Margaret. This is a singular year for Meet the Press. 70 years of superb journalism, the oldest news broadcast on television, and the fact that it is now led by Chuck Todd makes this anniversary even that sweeter. So, it is my privilege and pleasure to talk about the program, its legacy, and my friend Chuck. I think I was born watching Meet the Press. It was required viewing in our household. In fact, my parents did not really get excited when I joined NBC News in 1978 until they first saw me on Christmas of 78 on Meet the Press. Then I had finally arrived in the Mitchell household. Like so many of you, you've experienced American political and cultural history all coming alive by watching Meet the Press. Where else could you see Fidel Castro speaking English in a memorable broadcast when he came to New York and Washington? Or a wonderful moment that I treasure when Menachem Begin mistakenly was hooked up to the host IFB on a remote interview and took a producer's instructions literally. So our viewers heard the Israeli Prime Minister ask, "Say goodbye?" I can't really do Begin, but it was pretty unique. Perhaps the most contentious Meet the Press I ever participated in was during that incredible weekend during the Clarence Thomas hearings. Right in the middle of the hearings, of course, the Sunday morning television before the important decisions that were made that afternoon, which were, of course, not to call back witnesses and not to permit Anita Hill to introduce the polygraph exam, which she had passed. And during that Meet the Press, Alan Simpson, someone I had a long friendship with, but Alan Simpson said that he had received derogatory information about Anita Hill, quote, over the transom. Recently, he publicly apologized for that spurious accusation. that it was all part of the emotion of that incredible weekend. It was very difficult to cover. I think the only good thing that ever came out of that weekend of television and of broadcast and of reporting, I teased my good friend Ruth Marcus. The only good thing that came out of it was that for those of us covering the hearings, that's where Ruth met John Leibovitz. So at least one marriage came out of all of that. But that was a real test of all of us. We think now of the kinds of information that we are having to experience and that we put on television, but it was shocking for all of us to hear that testimony live, and it was before cable had come to NBC, so it was really interrupting the broadcast and just going wall to wall with coverage till midnight on that incredible Friday night. In recent years, we've had the memorable interviews, Tom Brokaw's powerful conversation with Colin Powell on race in America. It's been said that Tim Russert, of course, reinvented Meet the Press when we went to an hour in the broadcast, but Chuck Todd is now the custodian of that long legacy, introducing MTP Daily on weekdays, doing the 1947 podcast, hosting a documentary film festival, featuring three documentaries that were, in fact, later nominated for Academy Awards. It's just a scene this past weekend. But of all the things that Chuck is known for, of course, it is his encyclopedic knowledge of politics, not just the numbers, but the people that drive the political conversation. That is the skill that informs his weekly data downloads, his dead-on political analysis, his instinctive understanding of cultural touch points, and of course, his favorite sports teams. Above all, Chuck is a fierce defender, not only of the legacy of this broadcast, of which we are so proud, but of the First Amendment, at a time when all of us are facing unique challenges. And of course, there have been the memorable interviews, a new phrase in our lexicon, alternative facts, emerging from one of his follow-up questions. For all of those reasons, it is such an honor and a privilege to salute a show that never deals in alternative facts, and its leader, the moderator, Chuck Todd. Here is a brief video.
An informed public means a strong republic, and Meet the Press is dedicated to that cause.
To be actually in control of your party, you must be a well-trained politician.
I am not communist.
We have waited for well nigh 345 years for our basic constitutional and God-given right.
A strong Israel is not only the best guarantee for peace, but is the best incentive for peace.
We do hope that some common ground can be found.
You're against terrorism?
Definitely, I'm against.
You're proud of the shooting up of civilians in a hotel in Israel?
Could you push the nuclear button?
I can do whatever is necessary.
Were you involved in the president's decision to sell arms to Iran?
I am not ever going to discuss what I talked to the president about.
Do you really believe that Dan Quayle is the best qualified person who could be on that ticket?
I think in the long run, it's going to prove to be a good choice.
Would you be willing to retract or apologize for some of the things you said?
I have nothing to apologize for.
Senator John McCain, thanks for joining us and sharing your views.
I haven't had so much fun since my last interrogation.
Have your views evolved?
Men marrying men, women marrying women, and heterosexual men and women marrying men are entitled to the same exact rights.
Alternative facts are not facts. They're falsehoods.
Here's what I think Assad's telling Trump by flying from this base. F you.
You used the initials, but I think that's a first for Meet the Press.
I have no doubt that I can beat Mr. Nixon.
Watergate matter should have been handled properly. Apart from the fact that it was wrong, it was stupid.
Oftentimes, simple truth is not understood.
Neither I nor the American people would support the sending of an American team to Moscow.
Some people, when you say the word conservative, automatically think you're talking about a monster who eats his young.
Jumping on rhetoric seems to be a favorite game here.
I don't think that the president gets anywhere by making any comments on the press.
First of all, I expected to find the weapons.
When I take executive action, I want to make sure that it's sustainable.
In 4 years, you're going to be interviewing me and you're going to say, what a great job you've done, President Trump.
As long as the press of America is free, America will be free.
There was a time when Meet the Press was the only place you could watch reporters ask leaders tough questions. Well, NBC News started something here, and it's a legacy we're most proud of. If it's Sunday, it's Meet the Press.
Now you can see why we are so proud of Chuck Todd and Meet the Press.
Is it okay if we use if the staff here uses the bowl, kind of like the Stanley Cup, we'll all have our glasses of wine out of it on there. Andrea Mitchell once again proving she is the hardest working person at NBC News. Not up here once, but twice. Thank you, Andrea. I always say you're easily become one of my great friends and mentors and partners in so many ways. First and foremost, I want to thank the RTDNA for the devotion to the industry, for your commitment to what you're trying to do tonight, and for honoring Meet the Press. And so let me say this, on behalf of Martha Roundtree, Ned Brooks, Lawrence Spivak, Bill Monroe, Roger Mudd, Marvin Cowell, Chris Wallace, Garrett Utley, Tim Russert, Tom Brokaw, David Gregory, myself, and that great team over there, thank you. I'm ashamed to admit, but I've always sort of taken the freedom of the press and the idea of freedom of the press for granted, at least in my lifetime. There's never been a question of the press's sanctity, its importance, its place in our democracy, what it means, why it matters. We're having a robust discussion about that these days. What's interesting is the most frequent feedback I'm getting lately from viewers is this concern for our profession. For our classification as fake news, for undermining the truth. But I do want to underscore something that David said. This isn't new. The criticism is just a little bit louder and a little more noticeable. The truth is, what Meet the Press was built upon, now more than 70 years, the broadcast sets the stage for holding public figures accountable. And what's kind of nice is when you think about Meet the Press, the idea of a press conference, asking questions in front of a camera. Now we do it, we take it for granted, we do it every day, but that's the thing I'm most proud of being involved with Meet the Press, because it's the cornerstone of what modern political journalism and the great journalism that's being acknowledged tonight got started, especially when it comes to holding leaders accountable. And the beauty is, I'm not an idiot. I know that it can't be just a Sunday show. So we've decided, you know, if it's a day, it's Meet the Press, except Saturdays. We've decided to only work on Saturdays and take all the Saturday nights away from my great staff. But we're Meet the Press, we don't want to think of it as a Sunday show per se. It is an idea that has evolved from radio to television, from a half hour to an hour, under the guardianship of those 12 moderators that I humbly accept this award on their behalf. The idea that Americans deserve answers from their leaders, that the First Amendment must not only be defended, but championed. It's an idea that has never wavered. So as I look out in the room, I am reminded of our collective power. And as a press corps, we are not only each other's allies, we are the American people's ally. That's ultimately what we're here to do. I love that phrase, comfort the afflicted and afflict the comfortable. There's some truth to that. One thing we're not, is the opposition. We've never tried to be a part of the political debate, but people want to drag us into it. We shouldn't take the bait. We're simply a voice of truth. There's no balance, there's just fairness and truth. And a true voice and the truth is what we all need to be hearing right now. A voice that no matter how many disparaging tweets or calls of fake news, we can't let it be silenced. So, to quote the great wisdom of Uncle Ben to Peter Parker, with great power comes great responsibility. This is something I think we all need to be mindful of. It wasn't that long ago that the American public lost a little faith in us when it came to our coverage of the Iraq War. We can debate among ourselves about the coverage of it, But the public decided we didn't do a good job covering the Iraq War. And it is hard to push back at them on that. This time, we can't mess this up. This is what we're doing now. This is our Iraq War. And if we blow this, if we lose more, if the public loses more faith in us because of, if we don't cover this moment correctly, then we will have a problem when it comes to the press, and we will have a problem when it comes to our own credibility. So for the future of journalism to thrive, we are all accountable and all responsible for each other's reputation. And there's no doubt some want us to fail. We can't let them. Our collective conduct, our collective reporting, all of our sourcing, all of our tweets, they are reflective of not just me as an individual, NBC News or Meet the Press, but of the entire press as an institution. Nielsen cannot be our senior producer. And Viral can't be our... And the idea of Mr. Viral can't be a guiding light either. Rather, it must be our high standards that David talked about so eloquently for fairness and credibility. It's all we got into this business to do. So let's continue to set that high standard. Let's realize that we each have each other's reputations in our hands. And so when you're thinking about that moment of whether to be a little snarky, remember that that tweet could end up being, we're all going to be judged by it, or we're all going to be judged by that snarky comment you made. And it only hurts all of our collective credibility. So if there is one thing that I wanted to leave here with a message tonight, it is that, because I think there's plenty of people trying to undermine what we do for a living. There's plenty of people that are motivated to undermine us for their own gain, political, financial, or whatever. Just keep that in mind. We just need to be fair, credible, honest, and most importantly, transparent. Because I believe in the 21st century, transparency is the new objectivity. And I think if people see how hard we work, see how hard we try to make sure that whatever we're airing is the truth as we think we know it at that moment. I'm not going to say we don't make mistakes, but to the best of our ability that we're telling you everything we know. And maybe the best thing we can do is show our work a little bit more. Because, hey, we are in this day and age of social media, and I think there is an expectation that they see everything. So let's show our work. Let's prove to the world what we all know in this room, which is there's some tremendous journalism happening and taking place right now. Let's let it flourish. Let's support it. Let's let it thrive. And let's keep protecting that First Amendment. Thank you very much.
You know, I'd say it's part of the hazing of the new kid to toast your so-called competition, but I have to tell you, Chuck Todd has been so gracious in welcoming me to Sunday mornings, and his team sent over champagne to the Face the Nation offices when it was announced I was joining the team. And if you want to win over a bunch of journalists, as you all know, bottles of alcohol always go really far. Well, there you go. And the real note was, enjoy no longer having your Saturday night. but Chuck, it's good to be alongside you. Now, to present the RTDNF's 2018 Lifetime Achievement Award, please welcome to the stage ABC News Chief Foreign Affairs Correspondent and this week co-anchor, Martha Raddatz.
I have the easiest job of the night and the most honorable person I know, and I can see you right there, Robin, and all I have to do is look at you. You are astonishing. Robin Roberts is the embodiment of everything everyone has talked about tonight, but she is much more than that. When people ask me what it takes to be a good journalist, I say, you ask tough questions, you go there, you breathe it, you smell it, then you write it. But there's something more to a really good journalist. You have to be a really good person. You have to have a heart, and you have to have a soul. And Robin has the best heart and the deepest soul of any journalist I know. I love Robin Roberts. She has been the best colleague anyone could ever ask for. And I have much more to say, and I want you to watch it now.
Life is a journey.
Yes, it's a journey filled with hopes, marked by achievement, fueled by inspiration. It's the story of one of the most loved and trusted broadcasters.
Good morning, America.
And I might add, someone I'm thrilled to call a dear friend. So what can we tell you about Robin? Well, long before she became the Robin we know today, she was a little girl in pigtails. I mean, who could resist that face? Growing up in small town Mississippi at the height of the civil rights movement, her father, whom she adored, Colonel Lawrence Roberts, was a decorated member of the legendary Tuskegee Airmen, the first African-American pilots in the U.S. Armed Forces. Her mother, her guiding light, Lucy Marion, was a teacher and the first African-American to head Mississippi's Board of Education. Leading by example, her parents raised Robin and her three siblings to believe that they could also accomplish anything.
Mom and Dad always made us feel as though you are a Roberts and you can do this. They made us believe that we would achieve in life.
A star athlete and student in college, Robin dreamed of a professional career in basketball. But that just wasn't possible for women in the 1980s, so she found a different outlet for her other passion, journalism, landing her first job at a small radio station in Hammond, Louisiana.
In walks this bright, vivacious college student, and she said she was Robin Roberts, and she was willing to do anything. She was very good at everything she did. She's such a talented person.
Then it wasn't long before Robin was on the move to TV. She fought to get herself hired at local stations throughout the South, eventually catching the attention of the news director at an NBC affiliate in Nashville.
I was really taken in by her presence, her maturity, the way that she conducted herself on camera. It was one of those great moments when I thought, this is really just too good to be true.
After Nashville, Robin moved on to Atlanta.
Watch my special report on TV5 Eyewitness News.
And then it was only a matter of time before national audiences met the woman who would change sports broadcasting.
In 1990, the business was very macho. For an African-American woman to come into that situation was almost unheard of at the time. It was extremely difficult every single day to come in and have to prove herself.
The NCAA championship game.
She was never, ever intimidated by that whatsoever. She was all in. Let's play.
ESPN, my goodness, a sportscaster's dream. She had moved up to the big leagues. I think Robin pushed herself not because she felt like she had to set an example as a woman and a black woman. It was just in her DNA to want to be the very best that she could be.
The one player that you go to is Robin Roberts. She'll step up to the line and make that free throw for the win.
Last year's women's Final Four outdrew the men's.
Robin quickly became a symbol for women in sports, whether they were in front of the camera or behind the camera, because Robin Roberts was their symbol of excellence.
And it was that excellence that caught the attention of executives at ABC News.
From the moment you walked in the door, it was just freeing for everybody to be in the presence of the spirit. It was incredibly and immediately more joyful when she was around.
Our pal Robin joins us here at the anchor desk.
And then in 2005, America would see a more vulnerable side of Robin when Hurricane Katrina bore down on the Gulf Coast, affecting millions, including Robin's family and friends in her hometown in Mississippi.
You hadn't been able to make contact with your own family yet. Have you done so?
They're fine, and
to so many people, excuse me, so many people affected by this storm who can't get to the loved ones.
They watched her, whether it was hurricane coverage, feel exactly what they were feeling, and then gave us all a lesson in hope and possibility.
We wanted you to hear it from us, didn't want you to hear it anywhere else, and it's now been able to say it out loud. I have breast cancer. I'm only
human. Robin bravely let viewers into her journey. We all celebrated with her when she went into remission in 2008. But in 2012 came another diagnosis. Her treatment had given her a deadly blood disease called MDS. She would need a bone marrow transplant to save her life.
Sometimes treatment for cancer can lead to other serious issues, and that's what I'm facing right now.
What she was about to face was going to be by far and away the most painful ordeal.
Now Robin's family had never been more important to her, as her sister Sally Ann was a bone marrow match. The treatment would force Robin to be quarantined.
I am going to beat this, and my doctors say it, and my faith says it.
And it was with that abiding faith and tough as nails Robin determination to help others that led Robin to reveal the most intimate moments of her journey to drive awareness about transplantation.
She could feel the love, and she could feel the incredible force of this wave of people willing her through this and to come back to them, to come back with them.
And when she returned to GMA.
Hi, it's Robin, and I have been waiting 174 days to say this. Good morning, America. I'm on top of the world. Hey.
Through her bravery and her reporting, the National Bone Marrow Registry, Be The Match, saw an historic spike in the number of people registering to donate. What came to be known as the Robin Effect.
I'm honored to present the Arthur Ashe Award for Courage to Miss Robin Roberts.
I was thinking how proud Lucy Marion and the Colonel would be of their great daughter.
Because of all the donations, research, and support, mine is one of the lives that's been saved.
And how happy the rest of Robin's family who were present in the audience were to see their sister honored in such a prestigious manner.
She came through breast cancer. She came through myelodysplastic syndrome. And she can persevere through any storm.
Robin continues to connect with Americans as only Robin can, and leads the way as a journalist.
There's a lot of responsibility that goes with doing what we do. I mean, we're journalists and we cover very important stories.
Mr. President, are you still opposed to same-sex marriage?
I think same-sex couples should be able to get married.
I don't have to tell you this, Amanda. There's some people who are never going to be convinced that you are innocent. You never wanted to make this about race. You wanted to make it about justice. You're unemployed. Donald Trump is president.
Certainly has crossed my mind.
But it's also trying to do whatever we can to add to someone's life. I think about the time that we were able to reunite a family. Little Maya Esther, still at an orphanage in Port-au-Prince when the earthquake struck.
You found her?
Yes, we found Esther.
Well, thank you! Thank you so much!
So you're 10 years old now.
That was actually one of the greatest moments of our life, Robin.
To give them hope when they need hope.
You ain't get this cancer about you. Let's do it. Let's hope.
There are no words that she is doing as well as she is. Leah, we love you.
Okay.
Okay? I do not take lightly that I have the opportunity to say...
Good morning.
Good morning, America.
Good morning, America. Good morning, America. That never gets old.
After almost 30 years at the network, 13 is co-host of GMA with dozens of primetime special events and award-winning new content produced through her production company, Rockin' Robin Productions. This Lifetime Achievement Award recipient, extraordinary journalist, athlete, dear friend, is just hitting her stride. And we're lucky to be able to call her not only a colleague, but an inspiration.
Every now and then, someone comes along in our business who is simply one of a kind in every way at every level. She's singular. She has a singular song. She has a song of belief. And that's not just a gift to a television audience. That's just a gift to everybody.
present the Lifetime Achievement Award to the exceptional, astonishing Robin Roberts. Thank you. I won't compromise. I won't say goodbye.
Oh, thank you, one and all. Goodness gracious. Martha Raddatz, stellar example of lifetime achievement. So proud to be your colleague and friend, and it's a whole lot of fun as well. To all of my ABC colleagues that are here, President James Goldston, thank you for being so fearless and fierce. Tom, Barbara, our executive producer at Good Morning America, Michael Korn, oh my goodness, Steve Jones leading our radio division, and that's my first love, radio, you saw in the video. I was a student at Southeastern Louisiana University, majoring in communications, went to the local radio station in town and said, I want to be your news director. I want to be your sports director. Let me work. And they said, you can do that. We'll let you have a primetime radio show, but you're going to have to DJ on the weekends. And I'm like, going, you know, you're in college and I'm already busy. And they said, oh, did we tell you we're a country music radio station? I remember it oh so well, WFPR 14 Country, hometown kids' friends since 1947. Robert Nay here, Richard on Saturday night, playing the best in country music. Remember it well. Oh, Saturday night in that little radio station, and Bubba would call in. You sound pretty. I want to bring you home to meet my mama. I'm like, no, you do not. Trust me, would not work well for either of us, Bubba. You bring me home. My colleagues at my production company, John, Evelyn, Jeffrey Jacobs, all of you, Rennie, you bring out, all of you, bring out the very best in me. You challenge me each and every day, and I'm eternally grateful. Congratulations to all the award recipients tonight. You are a hard act to follow, and I don't mean just tonight. I mean in everything that you do. I'm in awe of all of your vast accomplishments. To this fine organization, bless your hearts. Thank you so much for this honor, and more importantly, for protecting us. So grateful for that. I know it's being said that responsible journalism is more important than ever before in light of what's happening here in DC and all around the world. I'm also grateful, though, that early on in my career, I was taught that responsible journalism mattered from the very beginning, from the mentors that you met in that video, Mary Perosco, my first boss at WFPR, Alan Griggs, news director in Nashville, who is now a professor at a university in Nashville, teaching young journalists, and how incredibly lucky they are to have that man. And when I think about the very beginning, how grateful I was to be taught those qualities, our beloved parents, Lawrence and Lucy Marion Roberts. They met and fell in love here in DC. They were students at Howard University. And as you saw, my father went on to be a Tuskegee Airman, my mother a longtime educator. And how lucky I am to be the baby sister of Butch and Sally Ann and Dorothy. Oh my goodness. I benefit from their counsel and that of mother and dad as they cheer us on from their heavenly balcony right now. My sister Sally Ann, who I'm amazed she's not praising the Lord right now. She's usually, her hands are up to the heaven. Yeah, there she is. Yes, thank you, Lord. Because our parents taught us the three D's. And those parents taught the three R's. We were taught the three D's: discipline, determination, and the Lord. Those were the three D's in the Roberts family. But my sister Sally Ann last week retired after 40 glorious award-winning years as a news anchor and reporter in New Orleans. What an example with all three siblings I had in my home, all teaching me to not let fear stand in the way of your destiny. And our family motto, which I feel is very appropriate for why we are gathered here this evening, We may not have it together, but together we have it all. Blessings to all, and thank you for this award.
What an incredible evening. Thank you to all of our honorees this evening, and a special thanks to our host this evening, Margaret Brennan. And thank you all for coming this evening and for your support of RTDNF, and good night.
Ladies and gentlemen, please find your seats. Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. The 2018 First Amendment Awards program will begin in just 5 minutes. Ladies and gentlemen, please rise for our national anthem as the Joint Armed Forces Color Guard of the Military District of Washington presents this symbol of our country.